much time because sister has a lot to share with us. So let's welcome Sister Jane. Welcome, Sister Jane. You can take over.
Thank you, Brother Chris. Good evening, my dear brothers and sisters.
Good evening,
sister. I'm happy to share the word of God today with the Sharjah English Charismatic Group. And I'm sure you all are on fire. We have just celebrated the Feast of Pentecost. And, you know, over the past couple of weeks, we have been, all the liturgical readings were focused on how to be witnesses for Christ, having received the power of the Holy Spirit. And Brother Anthony, during the course of his praise and worship, also mentioned that we should fulfill God's purpose for our lives. And so my talk is based on how we can get ready for that mission that God has in mind for each one of us. So I'm going to begin today's question with today's teaching with a question from the Gospel of Saint Matthew. I think Brother Thiru is going to share the slides as I preach the word of God. And I know that your audios and videos are muted, so I'll be giving the answer myself. The Gospel of Saint Matthew ends with a commission. Go and make disciples. It's a command. Go and make disciples. That's Matthew 28 verses 18 to 20. And Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always till the end of age." These words from the Gospel of Saint Matthew are known as the Great Commission. It is a commission, a command, or a mandate given to all Christians. We are all required to make disciples of nations. But frankly speaking, to be honest with you all, this Great Commission has been our greatest omission, because many Christians are not even aware that such a commission exists. And even if we have heard these words from the Gospel of Saint Matthew again and again, we have never really grasped the meaning or the implications of this commission. Although more than 2,000 years have passed since we have received this mission from Jesus, in the words of Saint Pope John Paul II, this mission is only beginning, and we must commit ourselves wholeheartedly to its service. In his 2013 Apostolic Exhortation, Evangelii Gaudium, which in English means the joy of the gospel, Pope Francis urged the entire church to embark on a new chapter of evangelization. He said, "The church must understand itself as a community of missionary disciples who are permanently in a state of mission." In chapter 3 of this exhortation, which focuses on missionary discipleship, this is what he wrote, and I'm going to explain this passage line by line. "In virtue of their baptism, all the members of the people of God have become missionary disciples." That means ever since we were baptized, we were chosen as missionary disciples. Becoming a disciple and making other disciples is the primary goal of the church. I repeat, becoming a disciple and making other disciples is the primary goal of the church. All the baptized, whatever their position in the church or their level of instruction in the faith, are agents of evangelization. That means every Christian is an agent, an instrument, or a channel of evangelization. And it would be insufficient to envisage a plan of evangelization to be carried out by professionals while the rest of the faithful would simply be passive recipients. That means It is not enough that we just employ a few skilled people within the church for this work of evangelization, while the rest of us play a passive role. The new evangelization calls for personal involvement on the part of each of the baptized. Every Christian is challenged here and now to be actively engaged in evangelization. That means, as Christians, we must take this role of making disciples seriously. But the truth is, my dear brothers and sisters, I cannot teach someone to drive unless I know to drive myself. I cannot teach someone French unless I am proficient in the language myself. Likewise, I cannot make someone his disciple unless I am a disciple myself. So the starting point of fulfilling this mandate given to us by Jesus is to understand the various aspects of discipleship, become a disciple, and then venture out and make others his disciples. There is a famous painting by the noted Italian Renaissance painter called, his name is Caravaggio, and the painting is titled The Calling of Matthew. In this painting, Brother Thiru, can you share that slide? Yes, St. Matthew is sitting at the table along with his wealthy friends, counting the taxes they have collected. Opposite him stands Jesus along with St. Peter. Jesus is pointing his finger at St. Matthew, calling him to be a disciple. Matthew is pointing his own fingers at his chest in disbelief, as if to say, Lord, you are calling me, the likes of me. Others around Matthew must have seen him as a greedy tax collector, a money-minded person, an enemy of the Jews, a friend of the Romans. Matthew too had self-doubts, but Jesus saw him differently. He saw him as a future evangelist. He saw him as an apostle, a writer of one of his gospels. Like Matthew, many of you may be struggling with self-doubts, my dear brothers and sisters. Oh, I have such a messed up past. I just don't have the knack, the skill of making disciples. Remember, my dear brothers and sisters, that God doesn't see us the way we see ourselves or the world sees us. He sees someone with a lot of potential to change the world, someone who can do incredible things for him. You have heard the saying, God doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called, he qualifies the chosen. That means it is Jesus himself who empowers and equips us for this task of making disciples. And just as Jesus trained Matthew, the other apostles, disciples, in the basics and fundamentals of discipleship before he commissioned them, he is extending a similar invitation to each one of us to be trained in the school of discipleship. And I would like to explain the school of discipleship which Jesus takes us through with the help of six C's: the call, the cost, the commitment, the conduct, the cleansing, and the commissioning. So let us begin with the first C, the call. The school of discipleship begins with the call of Jesus. Follow me is an invitation that Jesus is extending to each one of us. This call to follow him can come at any moment of our lives. Perhaps it may come at a time when we are least expecting it. Peter, Andrew, James, and John were fishing when Jesus called them. Matthew, as we have seen, was collecting taxes. Paul was actually on his way to Damascus to destroy Christ's followers. Yet once these people received their call, they left everything behind. Their fishing boats, their former lifestyle, their occupations to follow Jesus. there are some Christians who have received a call within a call, like Mother Teresa, for instance. For many years, she lived a very fulfilling vocation as a teacher of a girls' school in Calcutta. One day, while traveling from Calcutta to Darjeeling by train for her annual retreat, she received her inspiration or the call within a call. And that was to start a religious community dedicated to serving the poorest of the poor. And we all know what impact her yes has meant to the entire world. Like the apostles, the disciples, and so many people whom Jesus has called throughout the centuries, he never ceases calling out to us. He speaks to us through his word. He speaks to us through our circumstances, our situations, through our times of suffering, through people. Perhaps he's speaking to you through this pandemic, this crisis. Come, be my disciple. A famous saint who received his inspiration through the pages of the Bible is none other than Saint Augustine. For many years, he lived a very wayward lifestyle, even had a child out of wedlock. He would follow different philosophers, was attached to different philosophical thoughts. His mother Monica was continuously interceding for him. One day, these words from the letter of Saint Paul to the Romans touched him. Romans 13, verses 13 and 14. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Reading this scripture, Augustine felt as if his heart was flooded with light. All the darkness of uncertainty that he was facing vanished away, and he turned totally from his life of sin, went on to become a bishop, he's also known as the doctor of the church, counted among the early church fathers. Scripture played a crucial role in the conversion of Saint Francis Xavier's life too. An older student who is none other than Saint Ignatius of Loyola would often pose this question from the Bible to Saint Francis. That's from the Gospel of Mark, Mark 8, verse 36. What will it profit a man to gain the whole world and to lose his own soul? Little by little, the truth of the scripture entered Francis Xavier's heart and profoundly impacted him. And thus began a process that would make him one of the greatest saints in the history of the church. A saint who is very dear to all those hailing from the south of India, the patron saint of Goa. We have the example of so many Christians who have accepted this call of Jesus and have become such exemplary disciples that the church has canonized them, declared them as saints, so that we can imitate them in their discipleship. What about us? What about you and me, my dear brothers and sisters? Can you hear Jesus calling out to you? Whatever may be the ways and means through which he has been trying to get your attention, the crucial question is, what has been my response to his call of discipleship? Can Jesus, the Good Shepherd, confidently say about me, "My sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me"? The second C, the cost. Merely accepting the call of discipleship is not enough. We must count the cost if we wish to complete the school. Following Christ in this world is by no means an easy task. Discipleship is not a ticket to an easygoing, complacent lifestyle. Rather, it is a costly journey involving many challenges. Jesus never painted a rosy picture of discipleship. In fact, he warned his prospective disciples of the need for counting the cost. In Luke 14, verses 28 to 31, Jesus used two metaphors to warn his disciples about the need of counting the cost. A man building a tower and a king going to war. Both cannot succeed unless they have carefully contemplated and calculated what is expected of them. A man building a tower must calculate if he has the necessary resources to complete building that tower. And a king going to war must calculate if he has the military potential to defeat his enemies and win the war. Jesus doesn't want us to merely start training for discipleship. He wants us to complete it as well. One day, Jesus had brief conversations with three different people, which should give us some insight about the cost involved. The first one was a man who saw crowds following Jesus. And probably he thought, following such a crowd puller is sure to give him power, fame, fortune, in short, a secure future. And what was Jesus' reply? Foxes have holes, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Jesus was saying, forget about security, my friend. I cannot even guarantee you a roof over your head and a pillow to sleep on. The second was a man whom Jesus himself called, just like the 12 apostles. But unlike the apostles who left everything to follow Jesus, this man said he had obligations which he wanted to finish first. In short, he was postponing his call of discipleship. And what was Jesus' reply? Let the dead bury their dead. Jesus was saying, there are enough spiritually dead people in this world to take care of his affairs, but you get ready for the mission I have in mind for you. The third was a man who wanted to bid farewell to his family members before following Jesus. Now Jesus knew that the real problem was not of bidding farewell. This man was actually in two minds, whether to follow Jesus or to take a second opinion from his family members, who would have probably discouraged and dissuaded him from taking such a step. And that is why Jesus said, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for my kingdom. A double-minded person cannot serve me. He is just not fit for service in my kingdom. What about you? What about you, my dear brothers and sisters? Are you willing to forsake the friendship of this world? Are you willing to be misunderstood for the sake of Christ? In Matthew 24, verse 9, Jesus said, you will be hated because of me. To take a stand for Christ in today's world is not easy. To swim against the tide. To hold on to our Christian values and principles. I realized this once I had accepted the call of discipleship. But I had made up my mind. If I'm misunderstood because of my decision to follow Jesus, then so be it. There is no turning back. Amen. Pope Francis, in his first homily, said, once he was elected Pope, when we build without the cross, when we profess Christ without the cross, when we walk without the cross, we are not disciples of the Lord. We are worldly people. The next C, the third C, the commitment. Do you know why Jesus chose us as his disciples? Mark 3:14 says, Jesus appointed the apostles so that they could be with him and so that he could send them out to preach. Jesus has chosen us as his disciples so that first and foremost we will be with him. That means spend time with him and get to know him intimately. Service is no doubt important. We need to serve like Jesus, our master. But he is more pleased with us when we are first willing to listen to what he has to say to us. Jesus praised Mary, the sister of Martha. He said, she has chosen the better portion and it will not be taken away from her. Like Mary, a disciple must choose the better portion of sitting at the feet of Jesus. We cannot jump from our calling of discipleship straight away into ministry work. There must be a time of spiritual formation in the life of a disciple. And for that, we need to spend quality time with our master. Mother Teresa herself confessed that the secret behind her success was the time spent by her and her sisters before the Blessed Sacrament. She said, "I know I would not be able to work 1 week had it not been for that continual force coming from Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament." No relationship can grow without intimacy. Take any earthly relationship. If we want to be in that relationship, we need to spend time with that person. It is only when we are alone can we pour out our heart to that person, and that person can share his or her thoughts with us. Same is true of our relationship with Christ. Jesus himself gave the analogy of a vine and its branches. In John 15 verses 4 and 5, Jesus said, "Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as a branch cannot bear fruit unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing." We cannot be effective in our role as Christian parents, in our workplaces as God's witnesses, in our ministry work, unless we have a relationship with our master. Let me give you another analogy. What would you do if you wanted to build a good physique? You'd probably exercise, join a gym, walk, jog. You'd certainly watch your diet, watch what you're eating. A disciple must build spiritual muscles, and that calls for a certain degree of self-discipline. No goal can be attained without self-discipline. As a student, you have to study. If you want to be an athlete, you need to train. And if you wish to be a disciple of the master, you need to spend time with him. So set aside a time for daily prayer, personal prayer. Read his word, reflect, meditate on it. Avail of the sacraments. Mother Teresa also said, "God has not called us to be successful. He has called us to be faithful." Besides our commitment to spend time alone with Jesus, there are other commitments too. As a disciple, we must be committed to carrying our crosses daily. In Luke 9, verse 23, Jesus said, "If anyone wishes to be my disciple, let them carry their crosses daily and follow me." Secondly, a disciple must put his commitment to Christ above all earthly relationships and possessions. In Luke 14, verse 26 and 27, Jesus said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple." Strange words coming from someone who said, "Love your enemies." Here Jesus is simply telling us, put me before every single relationship in your life. Again, in Luke 14, verse 33, Jesus said, "So therefore, whoever of you does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple." Again, Jesus is not telling us to live on the edge, but as disciples, we must not allow our possessions to become more valuable than Jesus in our life. The next C, the fourth C, the conduct. A disciple must also imitate Christ in his conduct. The Greek word for disciple is mathetes, which is translated as a pupil, an apprentice, one who walks and talks like his master. A disciple must witness by his personal behavior and life example that he is a follower of Christ. Pope Paul VI said, "The modern world does not need teachers, but witnesses. And if it does listen to teachers, it is because they are witnesses." And how can a disciple be a witness? He can do this by developing a Christ-like character. And I would like to focus on three important areas for today's talk: Christ's humility, his love, and his complete obedience to his Father's will. One day, Jesus told his apostles that he was going to die. Now, rather than being concerned about him, they were concerned about themselves. Two of them, James and John, went to Jesus with a rather arrogant request. They said, "Master, when you are in your glory, we want to sit at your right and your left." And when the other 10 heard this, they were furious. "Two important positions booked. What about them?" Then Jesus called them together and he explained, "You know how the Gentiles lord it over their subjects? But it shall not be so among you. For whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be the slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Humility must be our hallmark as a disciple of Christ. Another crucial area we are called to imitate Christ is by the way he loved us. How does Jesus love us? He loves us unconditionally. He doesn't say, "First you change and then I will love you." Every time we falter and go to him with a repentant heart, he is willing to receive us with open arms. And Jesus has demonstrated his sacrificial love for us by dying in our place. That is the love of Jesus. Unconditional, forgiving, and sacrificial. And that is the kind of love a disciple is called to imitate. In John 13, verses 34 and 35, Jesus said, "By this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another." The third area, doing God's will. In John 6:38, Jesus said, "I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of one who sent me." Even in the fiercest trial of his life in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus was sweating blood, he said, "Abba, Father, let your will be done." Jesus put his heavenly Father's will above his will. And very often during the course of his earthly ministry, he would preach about the need for doing God's will. In Matthew 7:21, he said, "Not everyone who calls to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter his kingdom, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven." Imitating Christ, his character is certainly not going to be easy. It's easier said than done, because it requires a daily dying to ourselves. But then nothing that Jesus said was easy either. It is going to be a narrow way, turning the other cheek, praying for our persecutors, loving our enemies. Becoming like Jesus, our master, is our lifelong mission as a disciple. Remember, my dear brothers and sisters, Rome was not built in a day. Slowly and steadily, if we keep at it, we will gradually build our characters to resemble that of Christ. The next C, the fifth C, the cleansing. If what I have spoken to you so far, my dear brothers and sisters, seems challenging, let me tell you that I have kept the toughest part of my talk for the last. Besides the character formation that I just mentioned, a disciple must also go through an interior cleansing to make him or her fit for service in God's kingdom. Jesus called it the pruning process. And it is carried out by none other than the gardener of the vineyard. And who is the gardener? Our Heavenly Father, who removes every branch in us that bears no fruit and prunes every branch that bears fruit to make it bear more fruit. When does a tree bear fruit? When a plant receives adequate amount of sunlight, moisture, is planted in the right type of soil, receives water in the right proportion, grows in a suitable climate, and is pruned from time to time. That is when a plant will grow and blossom into a tree and start bearing fruit. It is a process. Fruit bearing does not take place automatically. It can only happen if we as disciples have a sincere desire to change, repent, and accept correction by the Holy Spirit. A disciple must always be a learner, willing to learn from his master. Sometimes, you know, my dear brothers and sisters, we are stuck in the same spiritual spot because we act, we react, we talk the same way. We are not willing to change. But when we are ready to accept what the Holy Spirit is trying to teach us through our situations, our circumstances, and we are willing to accept that correction, that is when we will progress in the school of discipleship and start bearing fruit. And how does this cleansing or pruning from our Heavenly Father that is so essential for fruit bearing take place? It takes place in two ways: through the trials we face and the temptations we endure. Thus, every trial is an opportunity for a disciple to learn new lessons in the school of discipleship. Lessons in patience, lessons in love, forgiveness, compassion, trust, and obedience to the Lord. Every temptation that we endure is an opportunity to overcome the devil, to put to death the desires of the flesh and the world, to make a godly choice. Besides fruit bearing, there is another important reason why our Heavenly Father makes us go through this painful process of pruning. He does it for our personal sanctification. Hebrews 12 verses 10 and 11. Now they means our parents, disciplined us for a short time as seemed best to them. But God disciplines us for our good in order that we may share his holiness. Now discipline always seems painful rather than pleasant at the time. But later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. In John 15 verse 8, Jesus said, "By this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciple." So fruit bearing is a proof that we are the disciples of the Lord. And what are the disciples that what are the fruits that a disciple is expected to bear? The Catholic Church has traditionally listed 12 fruits of the Holy Spirit. 9 of them are mentioned in St. Paul's letter to the Galatians: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, generosity, gentleness, faithfulness, modesty, self-control, and chastity. Cleansing may be the toughest part in our journey of discipleship, but this is the make or break phase. Our response to the Father's pruning will determine our destiny and the extent to which God can use us for service in his kingdom. The sixth C, the commissioning. Something amazing is in store for us, however, if we keep on persevering and continue bearing fruits of the Holy Spirit. The grace of the Holy Spirit, which probably until that time was dormant, will start getting activated in our lives. And when that happens, we are ready to be used by God for service in his kingdom. The reason God makes us go through this rigorous training of discipleship is because he wants us to be like that special utensil that St. Paul spoke of in his letter to Timothy, chapter 2, verse 21. If anyone cleanses themselves of the things that I have mentioned, will become special utensils, dedicated and useful to the owner of the house for every good work. It doesn't mean that we have attained spiritual perfection. That is a lifelong, ongoing process. But now the Holy Spirit will be doing his work through you, with you, in you. He will empower you to probably preach, teach the word of God, counsel people, engage in loving service, reach out to others through different gifts and charisms. When the work of building the church is done under the guidance, the anointing, the inspiration, the power, and the motivation of the Holy Spirit, the outcome is going to be totally different. It is going to be an amazing outcome. You will be able to reach out to others through your words and actions, touch them with your words and actions. As I mentioned in the beginning, Ministry work is not an option for a disciple. According to the Catechism of the Catholic Church, para 1285, for by the sacrament of confirmation, the baptized are more perfectly bound to the church and are enriched with the special strength of the Holy Spirit. Hence, they are as true witnesses of Christ, more strictly obliged to spread and defend the faith by word and deed. Most of you listening to my talk today must have received the sacrament of confirmation. Then we are more strictly obliged to spread and defend the faith by word and deed. We have not received the Holy Spirit to feel good and enjoy all the gifts and blessings for ourselves. We have received the Holy Spirit so that once we have been sanctified, we will reach out to others and make them His disciples. A disciple must make other disciples. That is our great commission. In Matthew 5:6, Jesus said, "Let your light shine before others, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." There is a beautiful story told about what happened when Jesus ascended to heaven. He was surrounded by his holy angels who began to inquire about his work on earth. Jesus told them how he had accomplished the salvation of the world through his preaching, his passion, death, and resurrection. Then the archangel Gabriel asked him, "Lord, now that you are back in heaven, who will continue your work on earth?" Jesus replied, "While I was on earth, I gathered a group of people around me who believed me and loved me. They will continue to pass on all that I have taught them." But the archangel Gabriel was not satisfied. He said, "But Lord, what if they do not pass on what you have given them? What will you do? Do you have any other plan?" Then Jesus replied, "No, I have no other plan. This must work." Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, if we do not fulfill our task of building God's kingdom on earth, that part will remain undone. In Luke chapter 10, verse 2, Jesus said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." Hence, it is important that we take this task of making disciples seriously so that we can fulfill God's mission for our life. So these are the six C's of discipleship: the call, the cost, the commitment, the conduct, the cleansing, and the commissioning. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, which phase in the school of discipleship can we who call ourselves followers of Christ identify ourselves? Have we even heeded his call? Or are we like that rich young man whose love for all his possessions and the fear of cost involved choked all his desires and he could not commit himself to the requirements of discipleship? Is God pleased with our character as disciple? Are we resisting our Heavenly Father's cleansing? Or are we leading and encouraging others to become the disciples of Christ, having understood our great commission? Think about it. Now I know I have spoken at length about the various C's. Before I conclude my talk, I would also like to talk about a big B, and that B stands for blessings. Saint Peter also asked Jesus one day, "Master, we have left everything for you. What is in it for us? What are the returns? What are the benefits?" Firstly, my dear brothers and sisters, we need to remember that Jesus, our perfect master, is with his disciples always. We disciples are never alone in this journey. Remember how the Gospel of Saint Matthew ends? "Behold, I am with you forever till the end of age." Also, Jesus promised Saint Peter that those who follow him will receive abundant blessings in this life and eternal life with him in the age to come. Disciples will be adequately recompensed. The book of Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6 says that God is a rewarder of those who seek him. Discipleship is not to be understood as merely sacrificing present joys for future happiness. No, discipleship is God's provision so that we lead a purposeful, meaningful life here on earth and afterwards partake of the joys of heaven. Jesus also said in John 12, verse 26, "My Father will honor the one who serves me." During a special disciples retreat that I attended some years back, the priest during the course of his talk said, "Only a disciple will receive fulfillment of his heart's desires." And I thought to myself, Jesus never said those words. And as I was pondering, this verse from Psalm 37 came to my mind, verse 4, "Take delight in the Lord, and he will fulfill the desires of your heart." A disciple is one who takes delight in the Lord, and that is why his or her prayers are answered. Speaking for myself, the journey of discipleship has not certainly not been an easy one, considering all the challenges involved. I have faced trials, temptations, there have been misunderstandings. I've had to make so many sacrifices. But my dear brothers and sisters, I've also known the joy of answered prayer. God has fought my battles for me. I have experienced so many victories in my life. I have received blessings, healings, favors. My life is filled with testimonies that I can share. Praise the Lord. The journey of discipleship with its twists and turns reminds me of a journey that I made to a hill station some years back with my family. Everything seemed fine as long as we were on ground level. But soon began the upward climb of about 4 hours to reach the hilltop. We took a vehicle, of course. The winding roads left us so dizzy and nauseated, not to mention our churning stomachs. Is this place worth the ordeal? Was the thought going through our minds. But everything changed the moment we reached the hilltop. The refreshing weather, the breathtaking scenery, the amazing view from our hotel room made us forget all the hardships of our journey. And we said, well, it was worth it. So it is with discipleship, my dear brothers and sisters. God has an amazing plan in store for us. And for that, we need to continue climbing to the mountaintop to get that mountaintop view. We cannot continue to remain at the foothills of our faith journey. Come to think of it, ever since we are born, we are growing. Even when we are aging, we say we are growing old. We are growing through our experiences, even through our mistakes and failures. Then why should we as Christians remain as spiritual infants, as spiritual babies, when God wants us to become his disciples, receive his blessings, lead a spiritually mature life, and be a blessing to others? When I accepted the call of Jesus, little did I know at that time of life that he was actually training me to be a disciple. I spent 10 years sitting at his feet before he anointed me to teach his word. I know that some of the things that I've spoken of today may not be possible during this time of pandemic and social restrictions and social distancing, especially those points related to Christian service. But let us use this time given to us to our advantage to develop strong spiritual roots. So when this time of crisis ends, and one day it certainly will end, God would have an army of disciples all ready to go out and win the world for Christ. My dear brothers and sisters, what an awesome privilege God has given us to share in this task of building God's kingdom on earth by making people of all nations, tribes, races, languages his disciples. Let us make the right choice, the wise choice of saying yes to his call of discipleship today. Amen. God bless you all.
Thank you, Sister Jane, for sharing the 6 C's of discipleship. I'm sure all of us will remember the 6 C's and will make disciples of Christ. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
And Amen. Also the big B, yeah, the blessings.
Yes, that's yes, also yes.
We should remember. It's
important, yes, we need
very
to.
Very important, yeah. Thank you. Thank you, sister, once again for all your time and effort.
Yeah, praise God.
Word of God, and hope to see you soon again, yeah. Thank you once again.
God willing, yeah, sure, brother. Yeah.